Church, I invite you to worship our strong and mighty God, who defeated sin and has given us the victory to live a holy life. Let's worship Him.
Become raging seas, even death can't hold you down. The sound of your great name commands the darkness to flee. Our God has the victory. You alone stand above it all. Strong and mighty, Jesus, you, the center of it all. Our God is strong and mighty. Nations rise and fall, you're unshakable, you're the everlasting life. All creation cries, make way for the risen King. Yes, our God has the victory. Yeah, you alone stand above it all. You're the Lord strong and mighty. Jesus, you, the center of it all. Praise will rise and magnify the risen King. Forevermore, you'll be enthroned in glory. Our praise will rise and magnify the risen King. Above it all, you're the Lord strong and mighty. Jesus, you, the center of it all. Our God is strong and mighty. You alone stand above it all. You're the Lord strong and mighty.
Well, hey guys, welcome to church today. Last week we looked at Ephesians 5, verse 18 to 20, and we said that if we want to act wisely in these evil days, we must let God control our lives, or let God control your life by the person of the Holy Spirit. Not sin, not alcohol, not any vice, not other people, but we must let God control our life. Now today, we will look at the second command that Paul gave to the Ephesian believers when it comes to acting wisely in these evil days. So the second thing that Paul said is that we must be responsible in our marriage, or be responsible in your marriage. And we will look at Ephesians 5 still, and let's start with verse 21. Now, the first thing that we can see here is that Paul is commanding the wives to be submissive to their husbands. So if we want to be responsible in our marriages, the wives must be submissive to their husbands. Let's read verse 21. And further, submit to one another out of reverence for Christ. And then he applied it in verse 22, for wives, this means submit to your husbands as to the Lord. Now, in the ancient Roman era, it was not unusual for a woman to be subject to a man. Traditionally, they will be submitting first ilang mga papa before marriage. And then if maminyo na sila, the authority will switch from their father padulong na pod sa ilang husband after marriage. Pero kini nga submission is kind of like a forced submission, right? It's a traditional submission. There's really nothing that they can do. However, Paul here is commanding the wives a different kind of submission. Now, the word submit in Greek is hypotazo, and it means to arrange oneself or place oneself, and here's the keyword, willingly under something or someone. So, lahi siya sa submission niya tradition because they have no choice nga mo-submit sa ilahang papa or mo-submit sa ilahang mga bana. But Paul is saying here that you must be willingly submitting yourself to your husband because that's a picture of the church willingly submitting to Christ. So for example, if magpa-enlist ka, nga mahimo kang police or sundalo or maybe members Air Force, dili ka mo adto sa ilang camp and then mayingon niya, hey guys, good morning, ako na di ay ang in charge. Okay, I'm new here, I'm a cadet, but I'm the in charge. Now, all of you must submit to me. You don't do that because you will be in trouble, right? You know, nga if musulod ka ingani ng mga organizations or workplace, you have to willingly put yourself under a leadership structure, sa chiefs, sa officers. And so that's a picture of this word. You willingly put yourself under the authority of someone or something. You know what? A lot of women, magpakasal sila, ay naa sila ingana nga mindset. Maminyo sila, and then niya, okay, since minyo na ta, I'm now the one in charge here. Okay, you follow everything that I say, you obey every decision that I make. That's wrong because the design of God is that the wives must be submissive, supportive sa leadership sa ilahang mga husband. So, ladies, when you get married, you willingly arrange yourself under the leadership of your husband. Okay, you're not forced to do it. Imuhan ang personal nga decision. Why? Because you love your husband, right? And that is part of the package of getting a husband that we don't really think of when we go into a relationship and then ma-engage ta and then magpakasal. Later on, we just discover, oh, it's actually part of the package, right? So, you know, it's better to understand first that this is part of marriage, that there are different roles. And the role sa wife is to be submissive and supportive sa ilahang husband. That is why, ladies and women, you have to be careful whom you marry, right? Because remember, you are marrying not a servant, but your leader. So, magpili ka kinsa imong himuon yung leader sa imong life. And you will voluntarily put yourself or willingly put yourself under his or her authority and leadership. So, you have to be careful. Observe the character of the guy that you have a relationship right now or maybe you are engaged to right now. Is he loving? Is he a good leader? Is he responsible? You need to be carefully observing those things before you put on that engagement ring. Because if not, you will be in trouble if you have married a leader but not loving and not a good or not a kind person. One of the business tycoon in our country, John Gokongwei Jr., about achieving success said, the most important decision you have to make in your life is whom you're going to marry. And that decision will dictate the rest of your life, whether you will live a happy life or a miserable one. And that is very true. So you have to be careful whom you marry. Remember, you are marrying a leader. Okay, so you have to be very careful. Now, here's the reason why wives must submit to their husbands. Verse 23, for a husband, listen, is the head of his wife, as Christ is the head of the church. Now, we don't really understand that phrase because we don't use the word head right now to kind of like refer to a leader or leadership, right? But that's what it means. You have to submit to your husband because he is the God-appointed leader sa kaminyon or sa marriage. Now, here's another part of that verse, which I think is very helpful as well to give us good reasons why wives must be submissive to their husbands. Not only that they are the leaders, but then Paul continued, he is the savior, okay, of his body, the church. Now, the wife's connection with her husband is like Christ's connection with the church. So, si Christ appoints ni God as the leader and the savior of the church, right? So, also, ang usa ka bana, ang usa ka husband, he is also appointed by God to protect and to lead the wife. Therefore, a wife must submit to her husband, not only because of his position as the leader of the family, but also because of his ministry or service as a human savior or human protector sa wife. Now, ladies, if you will realize that your husbands are actually your human savior and your protector, it will help you to be submissive to them. Not only in a position of leadership from God, but they also have this ministry of service for you. Because, for example, if you know that a person can help you in the future, you will be very kind and supportive to that person. Like a policeman, right? Like if naka relative nga nahimong police, or maybe batchmate nimo nga nahimong police, or kaila nimo nga dako-dako naglanggo sa military, what you will do when you meet them is that you will be very respectful to them. You know, pasnako nimo, pakanon nimo, you will be very kind. Because you're thinking, maybe someday makahelp sila nako. When I get in trouble sa road, or akong anak mo magbinuang, at least nako'y kaila nga nasa law enforcement. You know, or for example, a doctor. When you meet a doctor, you were never rude. You will always, good morning, doc. You know, yes, doc. You were very respectful. You're very kind of like supportive, very obedient sa doctor. Why? Because you're thinking, you know what, if magkidaon sa akong lawas, at least na ako'y doctor nga kaila, or na ako'y doctor nga maduulan. So, you're thinking about how they can be very useful for you in the future. That is why you're very submissive and supportive to them right now. You're not harsh. You don't put them under your authority. You are very, very supportive and kind and submissive to them. If imo siyang una-unaon, pwede na muna siya ma-apply ng principles of marriage with this idea that the husbands are the protector and the human savior of the wife. Submit to your husband because he is your leader. And then, respect him because you will need his help. Okay? You will need his help. Now, I know what this evil culture is saying. Women will say, well, women, we don't need a husband. Or some women will say, well, we don't need a man, okay, in our life. Now, let's be honest. We need each other. That's the reality. Let me start with the simple things, ladies. And by the way, there is a portion nga para na po sa mga bana later, okay? Don't worry, mga asawa. But let's start with the simple things that the wives struggles with. Like, wife, you have so many dresses that you cannot wear without your husband's assistance. Kaya ang zipper nasa likod, ang zipper gahi kaayo, ang zipper di nimo maabot. So you will always ask for your man's assistance, right? You have so many things that you cannot move without your husband's strength. Mineral water, a furniture sa imong house. When your car is broken, you will need your husband's strength. You have so many fears that you cannot face without your husband's protection or assurance of rescue. Cockroach, sometimes minor operations. Yesterday, Benz had a minor operation sa clinic sa ICM because na infect ng part sa yung tiil. And she said, I need you inside the operating room because I need moral support. Now, I was thinking, kuya wa ang mga bayi, no? You need those kind of things and it helps you. And that's okay, that's normal. I was thinking, need ba po dog moral support ang mga laki? Only very few, maybe. Most men, we don't even need support. Okay, We don't need any kind of support. We don't need moral support and any other kinds of support. That's just how men are wired, right? So, but ladies are different. You need those kind of things. And so what I'm saying here is that you have so many simple things in your life, wives, that you cannot really do well without your husbands or ang inyong mga men. And you have to see that you are designed by God that way, to depend on a man's service in small and huge things. So when you submit to your husband, when you support your husband, you are submitting to God because ni agree kaniya nga Lord, sakto ang imong design that I will be a woman and I will be dependent on my man, on my husband. So when you are tempted to disobey or lie or yell to your husband, remember that he is your God appointed leader, and then he will save you in so many situations in the future. He will serve you and you will need his help. You might as well respect your husband now, just like how you will respect people from the government, from the hospital, from any other establishments that you see that will be very helpful for you in the future. So respect your husbands. And in verse 24, Paul continued, as the church submits to Christ, so you wives should submit to your husbands in everything. Submits to your husbands in everything. Now, how will you react if you see a church, for example, that is not submitting to Jesus' words? So, kita kaning a church, pero obvious kayo, huwag man sila ga-follow sa Bible. Sin is not confronted. They're worshiping maybe idols or wrong ilahang doctrines, ilang songs, and ilang sermon. Unsa may buhaton nimo ni? Will you join that church? Of course not. Muna siguro ka nga, this is the worst thing that a church can do. Dili mo obey sa words ni Christ. It will result to discipline, painful consequences, and maybe judgment or maybe division or destruction you sa church in the future. You will say, this is unacceptable. How can a church not submit to the one who is the leader appointed by God and to the one who saved the church and to the one who will save the church? How can someone not submit to that? That's actually a good question for you wives. We react that way when we see a church not submitting to Christ, right? But how do you react when you see a wife not submitting to a husband? Because actually, it's the same thing. When Paul said, as the church submits to Christ, so you wives submit to your husband in everything, Paul is saying, a wife not submitting to a husband is as sinful, as improper, and as unacceptable as a church is not submitting to Christ. Parehas sila og magnitude. It is the worst thing that a wife can do, not to be submissive to your husband. And it may result to discipline, painful consequences, and maybe judgment from God. It is also unacceptable. How can a wife not submit to a God-given leader and to the one who will save her in so many troubles in the future? You must be submissive to your husband because the church must submit to Christ. Now, the church submission to Christ is a massive top priority and responsibility, and the wife's submission to her husband is again of the same magnitude. Without the church submission to Christ, there will be no church. And without the wife's submission to the husband, there will be no marriage. But then again, this submission is not force. You're not coerced to do this. This is a willful submission because you know who is behind the marriage, who has given you that man. What can that man do for you in the future? And what is your role in marriage? And so you willingly submit yourself under that husband. Now, Proverbs 12 verse 4 describes the effect of an insubmissive wife. A worthy wife is a crown for her husband, something that the husband can be proud of, something that will give honor to the husband in the community. But a disgraceful woman is like cancer in his bones. Marriage will be too difficult, too painful, too agonizing for a husband if the wife is not supportive and she is not submissive. Willingly submit to your husband. And the second thing that Paul said is that husbands must be loving towards their wives. Okay, husbands must be loving towards their wives. Verse 25, for husbands, this means love your wives just as Christ loved the church. And then another verse that Paul wrote in Colossians 3 verse 19 explains this further. Husbands, love your wives and do not be harsh with them. Now the Greek word for love here is the word agape, which is a love that freely and unconditionally offers oneself for the benefit of the recipient. Now, makapangutana ta, so giyon sa day paglove ni Christ ang church. If he wants the husbands to love their wives as Christ loved the church, how did Christ love the church? Next verse, he gave up his life for her, verse 26, to make her holy and clean, washed by the cleansing of God's word. He did this to present her to himself as a glorious church without a spot or wrinkle or any other blemish. Instead, she will be holy and without fault. So how must a husband love his wife? First of all, a husband loves his wife by making sure she is growing spiritually. By making sure she is growing spiritually. This is what Jesus did and is doing with the church. Now, why did Paul here emphasize the word holiness, if you will notice, or without fault or without spot or wrinkle? Perhaps this is due to the ongoing major satanic religion sa city of Ephesus. Remember, the worship of Artemis or Diana. And this religion, gihimo nila nga legal ang prostitution. Not only legal, but they, ila siyang gihimo nga part sa ilang pagsimba. And himo siyang normal kaayo nga buhaton. So, immorality is very normal and legal and part sa ilang spiritual worship. And so, most women were exploited on this matter. Sila gid kasagaran ang ma-involve ani. And women in this time, they are just considered nga like a goods that can be consumed by men. And so, this is a very satanic nga religion. And possible nga naay mga ni-join sa church who came from this satanic pagan religion, right? And Paul doesn't want nga madala nila na nga mindset sa church. Ngayon nga na ang value sa mga women. So Paul here is emphasizing the real church of God must be a holy church. And dapat dili sila pareha sa mga satanic, unholy nga religion. Especially, the women must be pure and holy in all areas of life, especially sexually. And the church must be very different kesa sa mga pagan religion na nag-exist ani nga city. And so Paul charged the husbands, okay, as the people or the ones responsible to make sure that their wives are growing in holiness, are growing spiritually. So this is a big, massive command, okay, big challenge para sa mga husband. That husbands, you need to minister to your wife just as how Christ ministered to the church. He gave up his life for the church to be holy. So essentially, Paul is telling the husbands to do everything they can for your wife to be closer to God and to live holy lives. And so the church will be filled with holy men and women. And this is important because sa kabisi sa atong life, sa kadaghan nga trabaho, especially ang mga wives, no? Especially if you are a working nga mom, sometimes makalimot ta sa atong mga spiritual priorities. Okay, we now forget to read the Bible, mag-start siya usa ka day, and then 2 days, and mahimang 1 week, and mahimang 1 month. Okay, and lugay na di kakayo, walay consistent nga time with the Lord. Makalimot na tayong pray, o deep nga mga prayers. Sometimes we neglect serving sa church because busy ragid ang life. Or sometimes na po yung mga wife nga ilahan ang i-choose nga direction. And so important nga ang ilang leader, ang ilang mga bana, maoy mo remind nila or mo encourage nila or, you know, moingon nga mag-date sa ta and then, you know, dito istorya ni mo ang imong concern. You know what? I think busy na kakaayo and I understand that part, but I want to help you get back sa imong spiritual walk sa Ginoo. So ang husband, maoy mag-initiate, you know, Tabangan niya ang wife, kuhaan niya ang load kung pwede, so the wife can focus on her spiritual condition, makabalik siyang basa og Bible, makabalik og pray, the wife can start serving na pun sa church, and we need those people, right? Especially ang mga wife. So, husbands, that has to be your primary goal, nga you need to make sure nga gag-grow ang imuhang wife. And that also means you must be growing spiritually too, right? You cannot lead them if you're not doing it yourself. A blind cannot lead the blind. And so, that's one of the primary responsibility of the husband, to make sure that your wife is growing spiritually. Okay, you love your wife by making sure that she is growing spiritually. Secondly, a husband loves his wife by providing and caring for his wife's physical needs. A husband loves his wife by providing and caring for his wife's physical needs. Verse 28, in the same way, husbands ought to love their wives as they love their own bodies. For a man who loves his wife actually shows love for himself. And no one hates his own body, but feeds and cares for it, just as Christ cares for the church, and we are members of his body. By the way, did you notice nga taas kayo ang command para sa mga husbands? Kay sa wife, murag pila naman to ka verse, usa or duha. Kay nagets nila dayon, but you know, ang mga bana sometimes, dugay ta makagets. I don't know, or maybe mas bugat lang gid ang atong responsibility. That is why daghang verse for us. But the thing is, a husband must love his wife by not only making sure that she's growing spiritually, she is provided spiritually, but she is also being cared for and being provided sa iyang mga physical needs. Now, in the Roman era, katong time nga gisulat ni nga part sa Bible, because of how the society valued women, it is very rare for a woman to have a job, okay? Or own a business or practice a profession. Most married women, they focus on being mothers sa ilang balay, and they don't have any source of income sa ilang own. And because Christ took care of his church, Paul is also commanding the husbands to take care of their wives, not only with their spiritual needs, but also regarding their physical needs. That is why sa ato ang culture in our church, and I hope it will be true to all of the younger people that we know, we say, get a job first before you get a wife. Because romance is good, but marriage needs cash. Okay? Get a job first before you get a wife. Romance is good, but marriage needs cash. And I just want to say, I salute all the husbands. I respect all those husbands that are giving their best and working hard, some of you night and day, just to provide for your family, just to take care of your wife and your kids. You're doing a great job, men. And ipadayo na siya, because I believe God is honored because you are taking care of the people that is important to Him. And to all of you who are still looking for job or starting small businesses, we will be praying for you guys that the Lord will make it successful. You know what? Because this is a very important aspect sa marriage. Now, verse 31, Paul continued, as the scriptures say, a man leaves his father and mother and is joined to his wife, and the two are united into one. And this is a great mystery, but it is an illustration of the way Christ and the church are one. The third way that you love your wife is, a husband loves his wife by staying faithful and then loyal. Okay? Husband loves his wife by staying faithful and loyal. Just as the church and Jesus are one, the wife and the husband are also one. And there are two things that Jesus cannot do to the church, and a husband must not do in his marriage: to cheat and to quit. Jesus will never do that sa church. And ang mga bana, dapat po dili ninyo nibuhaton sa inyuhang mga asawa to cheat and to quit in marriage. In this evil generation, cheating and quitting is normal, right? It is done by ordinary people. It is done by the influencers. It is done by celebrities. Makaguol sa ay maglantaw ka sa Facebook nga every week na lang halos na ay mga celebrities or influencers nga maapil o cheating or mag-divorce or magbuwag, no? Just like yesterday, I was reading the news and GMA News Online's headline said yesterday that a celebrity named Michelle Madrigal and her husband Troy Wolfolk are getting divorced. Another famous celebrity just quitting in marriage and they have a child, and that's what make it more painful. I challenge all of you who are married right now, we must not live like how these people live, and we must not view marriage just as how they view marriage. That when the romance is gone, when the feeling is gone, they will say, I think that's it. We're not meant to be. Okay, dilita para sa usag-usa, maybe nailain para nato, and it doesn't work. So, mundang na lang ta ani, mo quit na lang ta, magbuwag na lang ta. You know what's interesting? Naano nila tanan nga gipangita nato, na sila'y fame, na sila'y kwarta, na sila'y mga nindot nga mga lawas. I mean, kani nga couple, they were actually kind of like dubbed as a fit-spiration nga couple, okay, because they are very fit sa ilang mga lawas, but then didn't really work out. And Paul continued in verse 33, so again I say, each man must love his wife as he loves himself, and the wife must respect her husband. Now the third thing that Paul commanded to the Ephesian believers regarding acting wisely in these evil days is that we must be loving to our family, or be loving to your family. And now he will kind of like describe the proper relationship between parents and children. Okay, first of all, children must honor their parents. Okay, this is the wise way to live in this evil generation. Children must honor their parents. Chapter 6 verse 1 says, children, obey your parents because you belong to the Lord, for this is the right thing to do. Or honor your parents. Now, what does it mean to obey or to honor? Now, in the Old Testament, where the Ten Commandments was originally found, the word translated honor or obey is the Hebrew word kabad. It means to be heavy, weighty, grievous, hard, rich, or glorious, or burdensome. So in other words, our parents should be a significant priority in our lives. They must have a heavy weight sa imong heart when it comes to your priority. They should not be ignored or taken lightly. Our choices should take their needs and wishes into serious consideration. Dili sila ang pinakalast sa list. They are one of your priorities. And then in the New Testament, the Greek word used in Ephesians 6 verse 2 is the word timao. It means to determine the value of something. In this case, to determine that the value is high. And so it means we should give our parents a high value, even higher than ministry, and treat them accordingly. So that's what it means to honor. Now, the only time that we can disobey them is when they are asking us to do something that is not God's will for us, or that is not consistent with what the Bible is saying. But if what they're telling you is not sinful, not unbiblical, just the normal things of life, you must honor them. You must be listening to them. Now, it bothers me sometimes nga naay mga Christians nga mas dako pag respeto or pag honor sa ilang mga kauban sa church or sa ilang pastor kesa sa ilang own parents. So goon sila sa ilang ginikanan, nak, you know, ari sa diri, nak, tabangi sa ko diri, or nabakay time, wala na sila nga, ma, busy ko, or wala ko yung kwarta, or you know, wala ko yung time. But then, church mate na or pastor mo tawag, ha, pastor, padong na ko, may problema, karanda yun. Okay, or, amo ba, naglaag mo diha, nanak ko diha, padong na ko, wala yung problema. You know, that's bothering. Why? Because it shows nga nakay sayup nga priority sa imuhang life. Okay, if you are single, priority gid nimo ang imong mga ginikanan. Priority nimo imuhang balay. So, spend more time, effort, energy, and money para sa imong mga ginikanan, para sa imuhang family. Of course, don't neglect the church and your churchmates, but not to the point nga maneglect na nimo ang imuhang mga ginikanan. Now, here's a good motivation. Verse 2, honor your father and mother. This is the first commandment with a promise. If you honor your father and mother, things will go well for you and you will have a long life on earth. Now, sa may pasabot ani nga natay long life on earth if mo honor ta sa atong mga ginikanan? Well, first, yes, the promise is true. but in the universal sense, not in the individual sense. Because naay mga tao nga ni-honor sa ilang parents, pero namatay sila og sayo, di ba? And there are people who did not honor their parents, but live a long life. Therefore, it is a principle that is generally true, pero dili siya individually true all the time. If you honor your parents, God will, generally speaking, reward you with a long life. That is the possibility, okay? However, this promise does not override other decisions that we make, you know, that impact how long we live. For example, if a man honors parents, imong girespeto imong parents, imo silang gi-honor, but then you decide to commit suicide at an early age, of course, dili ma long imong life, di ba? Okay? The same can be said of those people who engage in reckless and dangerous activity, kanang kusog kayo magpadagan sa road, di mag-helmet, reckless mag-drive, or those people who don't take care of their health, though respectful sila sa ilang parents, but they're not taking care of their health, then of course, that could lead to serious injury, sickness, or a loss of life. And so, what we're saying here is this verse is generally true, but it's not a guarantee that it will happen to everyone because we still have choices that affects how long we live. The second commandment here that is very convicting for parents is this: fathers, do not provoke your children to anger by the way you treat them. Rather, bring them up with the discipline and instruction that comes from the Lord. The second thing about loving your family in this evil generation is fathers must not provoke their children to anger. Now, we can say parents should not provoke their children to anger, but Paul is addressing here the fathers because the father are the head of the family, and in most homes in the Roman era, the father implements the discipline at home, and they have the right over their kids, not their mom. Kibaliktad karon kay sa atong culture, the mom will always have the right sa ilang kids, but in the Roman culture, the fathers have the right sa ilang mga bata. And so, the word for provoke here in the original language means to irritate or arouse feelings such as anger, hurt, shame, and fear to the point of exasperation. The image is of an overbearing disciplinarian who constantly corrects and rebukes a child for every little mistake or perceived wrong. So, kada sayop sa bata, i-correct. Kada na siya'y buhaton, hindi ka mo yun, maski dili sayop, imuha dayong kasaban or insulto ng bata or imuha dayon siyang i-discipline or imuang latuson dayon. Maski dili ka sure kung wrong ba to or wrong lang ito siya para nimo. And such a father will provoke his children. And what will happen if ang anak nimo ma-provoke nimo into anger? Colossians 3 verse 21, fathers, do not aggravate, the same concept, provoke your children, or they will become, what? Discouraged. Now, the Greek word translated nga discouraged is found only here in this part. And it speaks of becoming disheartened or losing spirit. Such a discouraged child will close down his heart and hide inside himself. The child feels that he can never do anything right, and so he gives up trying to do what is right. Because every move, kasaba, every sayup, pain, every perceived wrong, butang, pakaulawan siya sa iyang parents. Now, it is embarrassing to admit this, but this is one of my struggle. You know, until now, sometimes, kinahanglan pa ko nga ingno ni Benz nga murag sobra na imong pag-discipline or sakto na ang imong gibuhat. And ay mga times na kaming duha ni Benz among i-date among mga anak, i-banding na mo sila, and usa sa purpose is ganahan rin may mag-apologize nila sometimes. Tungod kay harsh me or sa among kabisi or kanang sa kalisod sa life, usay sila mo atong mapahimungtan or mahungawan sa atong na-feel gikan sa work or sa ministry. Nakabantay ko nga every time ako like mo-apologize ko ni Yugi or mo-apologize ko ni Mikay, they will always cry. Okay, I don't know why, but ma-feel na ko usahin nga na sila'y ginataguan, nga dugay rin nga na-feel, or na sila'y na-feel sa una nga ilahalang gikalimtan, and then inig-apologize ni mo, murag mo balik tanan nila nga fear at nga time or discouragement. And then tungod kay nalipay sila nga nag-apologize ka as a parent, muhilak sila, wag ila nang let go. And by letting go, they will cry. And every time maghilak ang akong anak, like si Yugi or Mikai, if mag-apologize ko, I cry too. Because I can feel kung unsay na feel nila nga discouragement or maybe fear. Madlok sila sa ako at tungod sa akong pagsaka sa tingog or sahay ka na mag-discipline ta nga out of anger na dili na out of love. That is a healthy practice, by the way. Nga if ginikanan ka, ipakita nimo sa imong mga anak nga kamausad ka mag-apologize if ikaw na pud ang sayop. What will happen is makita nila nga my mom or my dad is real and I can actually relate to them. We can become friends because this is not a relationship nga ako lang kanunay ang sayop and sila kanunay ang sakto. This is a relationship nga sometimes sila dai pud ang masayop and it will create a good connection in you, especially if teenagers na. So maybe na uban ninyo nga mauni inyong application, no? Take your kids out, maybe somewhere nga makarelax sila or maybe sa balay lang and lingkod mong taraw and just tell them, you know what, I think I've been provoking you to anger. Basin nung nasubraan ra akong disiplina nimo, sorry. And you know, you will see nanindot kayong effect, ana. And we need to ask the question, is the way we instruct or discipline our kids in private or in public provoking them to anger and that is leading them to be discouraged at life? And so I think it's good to make it a habit nga mag-ampo kauna for God's wisdom. If nagplan ka nga disiplinahon imong bata or isulti nimo ni sa imong anak, pray if this is right, pray if this is from the Lord. So basically what we see in this evil culture is that the families are being attacked. And I think it's our job to keep our marriage intact and to keep our relationships sa atong mga bata nga solid and loving. Because this is the only way that a family can stand strong in this evil culture that is against the design of God for families. I think nakashare ko sa uban ninyo that one of the things that I did recently is to call a formal family meeting with Yugi and Mikai and Ben Sabalay because I just want to address something. And I noticed nga na busy na kayo among life. Na yung mga additional work, additional loads of ministry, and the kids are starting their school soon, antong a time, and so nag-decide yung I think it's good to just meet with the family. And it sounded strange to me antong a time, but then I realized mag-meeting man gani ang mga company, nga ang purpose nila is how to grow their profit. How much more should families have those kinds of important discussions na ang purpose nila is how to put God as the center of the family? And it was funny when I explained to the kids, hey guys, we will have a family meeting. They said, what meeting? Why? Why do we need to have a meeting in the house? Because it is very unusual, right? But what I did was I actually prepared for that meeting. Na ako'y gitype mga duha ka page ng aban paper about what should be our rules sa house. And then what should be our rules or what should be the things that we will follow sa marriage namo ni Ben. So basically the content of my presentation to them was like, how do we make sure na in spite nga busy na ta kaayo nga center gyapon si God sa atong family, sa atong marriage, sa among house. And then also, how can we make sure nga we can protect our marriage ni Benz karon nga time nga nagkadaghan naming responsibility, daghan naming people nga ma-meet, daghan naming time nga layo mi sa usag-usa. And so basically that was the content of the family meeting. And after mga pila ka oras tong istorya na mo, I was surprised sa result because the kids actually understood most of the details, yeah, that they have to use their gadget less so they can spend more time in studying and in reading the Bible and in interacting with each other and to us as well. Nga walay gadget involved. My wife understood my concerns. So right after that meeting, na changed yung ngamuang life. I mean, I would say we're now spending more time together in the Word, in prayer. My wife and I, we now kind of like understood each other more. I feel like we are more connected after atong meeting spiritually because I have shared my heart and she has shared her heart too. And so it is something that is uncommon, something that most families will never do. But then I felt like the Lord is leading me to do it. And the result was good for our family. And so I don't really know, but maybe this is your application for this message. You need to talk to your wife about your roles and responsibilities and making sure your marriage is intact and secure. Maybe some of you needs to be honest about your struggles sa inyong husband or sa inyong wife, and just to find ways how can we go back to focusing on God and His Word, not just in the church but in our home, because that is very important. And then maybe some of you needs to talk to your kids and say, maybe I have been provoking some of you or you to anger, and I just want to apologize for it and commit si daddy that I will learn from my mistakes and I will discipline you from now on in a biblical way. Maybe the first time nimo nabuhaton, magtanga siguro imong mga anak, like noon sa man ni si papa or imong wife, mingon niya, hilasa man ni. But you know what? I think that is needful and that is important, because again, we are living in an evil generation, okay? If you will not be intentional sa imong marriage and sa imong relationship with your kids, Satan and his minions can destroy your family. And he is destroying families right now from the inside out. And so it's better that you need to do something on what's inside your family, sa ilang hearts, before it gets to the point nga dili na ma-recover or dili na mabalik ang imong family. So I'm praying for your marriages. I'm praying for your relationship with your kids, parents. And may the Lord give our church strong, God-centered, faithful families. I'll see you next time.
You came from heaven's throne, acquainted with our sorrow, to trade the debt we owe. You're suffering for our freedom, the Lamb of God. Your blood pour out my sin, erasing was my debt. You died, I am raised to life. Hallelujah, the Lamb of God. My name upon your heart, my sin undone, the cross for my salvation, the Lamb of God in my place. Your blood pour out my sin, your raising was my death. You died, I am raised to lifted up. There is no grace.